Welcome to the Dirtcheapdaily. On this episode, I'm going to install a headphone jack in my Legacy Outback. I'm going to be installing an iSimple module. This will work in any car, but I'm specifically going to show you how to do it in a fourth generation Legacy. Alright, so these are the things you're going to need for the job. Obviously, you're going to need some screwdrivers and things to be able to get the dash apart. I also have a set of these pistol grip needle nose pliers that I've always found really helpful. We are going to be doing a little bit of wiring, so you're either going to want a soldering gun, a soldering iron, some solder, heat shrink, that kind of thing, or just some simple butt connectors and a crimper. Depending on how familiar you are with your car, you're going to need a multimeter or just a test light, and you're also going to need just a drill with about a 9/16 drill bit. So with the tools out of the way, we're actually going to go ahead and take a look at the iSimple module. So this is what I've installed on every single one of my Legacies that I've owned so far. There's one up ahead in the third generation Legacy Outback. And all it is this module right here. So the way this works is it taps into your stock head unit or your aftermarket head unit's antenna plug. It has a power and a ground and then a switch. So along with the unit, you're also going to need to purchase an auxiliary jack, 3.5mm jack to double RCA jack. And I just got this UGreen off Amazon for about $4. This module works by tapping into your antenna and then broadcasting a signal specifically on two different channels. When you want to listen to your auxiliary port, you plug in your iPod or your phone or whatever, then you turn on your on switch, and then tune it to the station that's set on the back of the module. So the iSimple does come with a set of pretty clear instructions, both in paper form and just on the back of the box. And so if you do have any other questions, you should be able to refer to those and be able to do this pretty simply. Now, I've always had perfectly clear audio with this. Because it has the on-off switch, you don't get any feedback or bad reception on any of your other stations. I really like doing it this way because you retain the stock head unit. I'm not a big fan of the aftermarket units that have like blue LEDs, and I just really like to keep that stock clean look on the dash. If you're doing this to a 2005 or newer Subaru, you're going to need two extra parts. They actually changed the antenna connectors. You're going to need to get antenna adapter cables, both a male and a female. Luckily, that's only $14 more, so it's still pretty economical to do this install. So before we get started on the fourth gen, I wanted to show you just exactly how slick this works, and I'll show you the install on my third gen. So this is my stock third generation dash. The head unit went bad in it, and I was able to put an Impreza head unit in that plugs straight in. The only difference is it's silver instead of black. That doesn't really bother me, because I still retain my 6-disc CD changer. And I was able to pick up this stock Impreza unit for only $20 on eBay. When I installed my auxiliary port, I actually took out the OnStar unit that was in here in the stock location, and I retrofitted it to put all of my iSimple module right behind all of this. So here I have my on-off switch. This button doesn't do anything, but I retained it just to make it look a little cleaner. And then I pulled out this other button over here, and this has a retractable auxiliary port just right in there. If it's just me in the car, I can shove this all the way in and go ahead and slide my phone right down here. And if I do have somebody else who wants to plug in, it'll stretch all the way to the back seat. So the really great part about this is I can turn on my radio. And my stereo works just fine with it on the off position. Now if I turn it on, you can tell.
Is it your local Y?
So with it on, you can tell that most stations don't sound very good, and that's why you need the on-off switch. This module I set to a frequency that I don't think I've ever heard a radio station using, and it just kind of ensures that wherever you go, you'll have a working auxiliary port and you won't have to compromise with any stations. Now, since I don't use my auxiliary port all the time in this car, I have it set just so that I can click on 6 and then go up 2 stations and I'm on. And turn on. And really, that's how easy it is. Then, when I'm ready to go back and listen to the radio, I can turn it off and go back to my stations
Warner Stallion's 3-day clearance sale is the real deal.
And not have any issues. So the first thing we want to do is start to pull apart the dash, and then we can kind of figure out where we're going to actually place the module, where we're going to run the on-off switch, and where we're going to have the auxiliary port come out. So in this car, I actually have a plan for this one. It's a really slick setup. Right here, I already have a 12-volt source. This car also has this little slot right here for cords to come out. And so I'm going to go ahead and route my auxiliary port just right in through here. I'll also be able to tap in to that 12-volt source right there. So the only thing that's going to make this more difficult is actually routing my antenna lines up into the back of the stereo. So you want to come in here with a few different screwdrivers. The first one, you want to have a relatively small flathead, and you're just going to pop this guy out. That little cover makes it so that you can put this in any gear you want it without having to have the key in. So I'm just going to go ahead and slip it right down in there. So now we want to pry off this chrome or black trim piece that surrounds the shifter. So again, if you're using a screwdriver to do this, be really careful. You don't want to crack or scratch anything, but it is pretty simple to get out. You just pop it right up and set it aside. So now you're going to take a little longer screwdriver and pop up this trim piece. Now that just pulls right out. There's one connector back here that connects the light on the inside of this ashtray and the power to that cigarette lighter. But you can pop it right out and go ahead and set that whole piece aside. So now you're down to here, and we want to take off these wood trim pieces. And so you want to come in here and take off this screw right here, and then you should be able to pop this whole trim piece out. I'm going to just scoot that up so it's a little more out of my way. And just like that. Now with both of those trim pieces removed, we can actually remove the stereo. So there's four Phillips head screws on each side. There's one that's deep down in there, so I'd suggest having a screwdriver with a magnetic tip so that you don't drop it. And so I've actually already been in here and taken apart this stereo. I pulled the stereo all apart, and I pulled the climate control unit off of it. There's a banner link to it, so go ahead and click on that if you want to see how these are taken apart. But since I already pulled the stereo out, I actually had this set up so I can reach the antenna cable without having to take the stereo out again. Now, it's not that big of a deal to take the stereo out. It is just those eight little screws, and it slides forward. You'll have to have the gear selector back far enough so that you can pull it out straight and far enough to clear it from the rest of the trim pieces. But since I had already done that and I knew I was going to come in here to put in this port, I made it really simple so that I could just come in here and weasel out that antenna cord and plug in my adapters. So that just unplugs like that. And now it's ready for me to plug in my antenna adapter cords and then plug in the iSimple. With the antenna cords ready to be plugged in, I'm going to focus my attention back on the center console. And so I open up the center console, pull out all the junk that's just kind of hanging out in there, and then underneath you have this felt pad that covers the base of the center console. Once you pull that out, you'll see two. You can either pull them out with a 10mm socket or just a Phillips head screwdriver. Now with those two screws out, I should be able to lift this whole center console up. You're going to have a hard time getting this leather unwrapped from the boot. And so all you have to do is hold on to the leather here and push down, and the boot will actually pop off so you can take the whole center console out by itself. Now before you can fully remove it, there are a couple of connectors you need to take out.
just so that you can get the whole thing out. So looking towards the rear of it, you can see a couple of connectors, but this main white one is the one that we need to take out in order to remove the center console. So with that removed, you can just lift up and set aside the center console. So the first thing I'm going to do is take both of my antenna adapters and just plug them in to the male and the female that I just unplugged. So there's the male plugged in and the female. And now my antenna cords can slide out all the way around or even down through here and come out back behind my shift setup. The other nice thing about the iSimple package is that these cables are already about 18 inches or 24 inches long, and so they should be able to route right up in there with no issues and still be able to keep the module towards the rear. Both of those can just slide right up alongside the shifter. And then I pull them out the front. And that gives me plenty of space to go ahead and just plug these guys right in, ensuring that they're in as far as they can go. There we go. And there's both of those. Now I'm going to go ahead and pull this wire back down through. Now I can grab a zip tie when I'm ready to button all this up and either zip tie it to this wiring harness or over here on this sensor. I do want to make sure that they don't interfere with anything with the e-brake. And it looks like they're just fine. So those look like they're going to be in a great spot right there, and I'm going to go ahead and leave that for now. So with that sorted, I still have a good foot and a half of cable to be able to mount my box in a good location. Now I think I'm going to have a lot of success mounting it right up underneath the center console in this area. Now I do need to be sure that it clears the cup holders, but I don't think that's really going to be that much of an issue. Now looking at the underside of the console, there isn't a whole lot of extra space, but I think there are a couple spaces that will be big enough for me to hide this little box. So I think one good option would be to put it right there, right underneath my heated seat controls. The other option is to put it right up on the back side here behind my e-brake. Another option would be to just slide it right in here, right next to the shifter, because that looks like it has plenty of space to put it right here. So both here underneath the console and here in the dash, right next to the shift assembly, I think are both really good spots, but what's gonna be my deciding factor is the easiest place to get power from. Because I would like to not have my power wires running all over the place. I wanna keep them pretty consolidated, and so I think either tapping in to this 12 volt accessory plug is going to be easiest, or tapping into the heated seat controls. So that's kind of why I'm thinking of keeping it in the console. If I can find a place to plug in up underneath here, I think that's where I'm going to go, because I would like to put it up in here. There seems to be a lot of space right there, and I know it's not going to be in the way of anything. Plus, taking off this trim piece is really simple, and it only takes 2 minutes. So if I do need to make any changes, either on the gain, or if I have anything come loose, I'll be able to check on it more easily than taking off the whole center console. So those are a couple of things I'm taking into account when I'm thinking of where to mount the module. I want to find a good place that has power easily and closely accessible, but I also want to be able to check on it and get to it relatively easily if I need to. Now, not saying that the center console is difficult to take off, just that this bezel around the shifter is a whole lot easier to take off. So that's a perk to having it in here. A perk to having it in here is that my power is so close and already exposed. With these power wires being pretty exposed, these look like a really good place to tee in and get my power and ground for the module. But I don't want to be plugging into a constant 12 volt that's straight from the battery. I want to be able to have it on switched power that is only on when the key is on. So I go and grab my multimeter or a test light and figure out if these are on all the time or if they're only getting power when the key is in the accessory or on position. If it's constantly powered, you won't even need to put your keys in, so you can just test it. But you do need to make sure you plug the harness back into it. Okay, with those sitting in there, touching the contacts, my multimeter is reading zero. So I'm going to go ahead and turn on my key. And even just on accessory, I have 12 volts. If I turn it all the way on, basically I'm still at 12 volts. And so this is a switched only accessory port. So I'm going to go ahead and tee into these two wires. They're exposed, really accessible, and that's going to make for a really simple, easier installation. Now, since I'm wiring into the console, I can just unplug the wiring harness, and no power will be getting to either of these two wires, and so there's no risk of shock or electrocution, and so that way I don't actually have to go in and unplug the battery. So you do get plenty of cable if you did need to run your box somewhere else, underneath the seat, or up underneath the dash in the glove box, somewhere like that. You do have plenty of cable to be able to do that if you need to. Before I go any further, I'm going to test fit my module. I'm just going to use double-sided sticky tape and put some tape on the back side of the module and stick it on here onto the inside of the console. Now you do want to be careful. You don't want to put the tape on this back side because this is your level or gain adjuster and you don't want to have that covered up in case you need to adjust it later on. So that stuck in, I'm going to go ahead and place the center console back together and make sure everything clears. And then I can pull it back off and wire it up. So you can see down in behind the e-brake is off right now, and there's plenty of room back underneath there. If I put the e-brake on, I'm still good. I do need to make sure my wires are routed properly so that they don't get caught up with this back edge of the emergency brake adjustment screw. But it is good to know that's a great spot. It's sitting right in here, and I'm going to be able to connect everything up and make it all work properly and pretty easily. Now, one thing I might do now that I see it how it is now, I'm probably going to run my antenna wires around on this side of the gear shift so that I can ensure that they're going to stay out of the way of the emergency brake when it's engaged and disengaged, to run it kind of on the other side of this cup holder up underneath and have them come over on this edge. That way I can make sure they're out of the way and they stay out of the way at all times. So with that done, I'm going to go ahead and pull the center console back out and wire in my ground and 12 volt. Now at the same time, I need to figure out a place to put my power switch. Now I want to put it in a place that looks good, that's not intrusive, or that feels like it didn't come that way from the factory. On my second generation Legacy that I did this on, I went ahead and installed it down here next to the e-brake. I think that's a good spot for it because if you're going to be using it, you're going to have to open up the center console and pull out the headphone jack. And so having the switch right here seems like a really good position to me. The other option would be to put it right inside here
And that might actually be pretty cool. It would be pretty stealthy because you can slide this shut and looking at it, it wouldn't look like anything has been done to it. You open it up, and if I put it here, it wouldn't interfere with any of the cup holders, but it would be an easy access to just flip it with my thumb on and off. And if you didn't want to drill a hole in any of your plastics, you could just kind of wrap it up and go ahead and shove it down in there. And that would work just fine as well. But since this is a car I plan to keep for a really long time, I think adding an auxiliary port would actually add value to it anyway. And so I'm not opposed to drilling a hole in any of my center console plastics. I do want to make sure it's in a good position that feels natural. I feel like having it right here would be pretty natural. I also feel like putting it on the inside would feel pretty natural, and I just like the added benefit that it's hidden. So I'm going to go ahead and take out the cup holder and see where I'm going to have space to be able to drill that. I think I'll have space for it. But in order to drill it, I think I need the cup holder out of the car. Okay, so I have the cup holder out, and I actually really like the idea of putting it on the inside here. There's a little lip in here, so it wouldn't get in the way of anything, and it's a really easy spot for your thumb to just go ahead and click it. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm going to drill a hole through on the backside and just route that through there. Pretty slick. So I just got the hole drilled. Now it might look a little goofy and not perfectly round, but that's mostly just because I didn't have a drill bit big enough. I don't have my step drill bits here with me or my Christmas tree bits, and so making a hole that big with the bits I had was just kind of grinding out until this little switch fit correctly. So now it fits really nice, and all you have to do is slide this in all the way, like that. Okay, so that looks really nice, very professional, and very low profile. Now the one issue that I have is with this like 3.5 foot long wire. Because it's just so much wire that I'm going to have to just like bundle it up and wrap it together and zip tie it, and it's going to make a mess. And so I'm going to go ahead and cut that and solder it about 2 feet shorter. I only need it long enough to get from here underneath the cup holder, and about here is where it mounts to the box. So I'm just going to go ahead and cut those with some crimpers, and then using my soldering iron, I'm going to re-solder those shorter. Pretty simple.
So I went ahead and put the cup holder back in. It's screwed in, and I routed my wires around and connected it up. Now I have my main power and ground wire run through that little section in between there, and I'm going to go ahead and route it right in to both of those. Now the way I'm going to do it, I'm going to go ahead and pull this connector off of these two clips and just solder these right onto the ends of those connectors. So I need to get a little pick and pull those connectors out, and then I'll be able to solder them straight on there and we won't have any issues. It'll be great. A super simple install, and hopefully it'll turn out well. Now you could also just come in here with butt connectors and splice those and splice them together with butt connectors, or just cut these and solder them into there. You can also get just, it's like a little clip, and it splices it in without having to do any cutting, and you just crimp it on and you're done. Those do work pretty well, but I'm just going to do it this way because I think it's the cleanest way to go about it. So. So with everything wired in, we can go ahead and grab our RCA to 3.5mm headphone jack and go ahead and plug that in and test it out. Plug in the harness again. Make sure your antenna's plugged in and go ahead and turn the key. So that's it. Now, I think I need to adjust my gain, because right now, I'm at volume 18 on my head unit, and I'm basically turned up all the way on my phone. And if I go to another station, let me turn off the unit. It sounds like my phone is a little quieter than the radio. So I'm going to go ahead and grab a little tiny screwdriver and adjust the gain on this box. Okay, so there's the audio going. Now if I switch, you can see how that's a little bit quieter. Turn this off. It's about the same. It's not perfect, but I think it's adjustable enough. I'm gonna go ahead and test it a little bit more with like audiobooks and things like that that I'm used to listening to, because I know my audiobooks, the volume is a little quieter than music. And so I'm going to make sure that everything's adjusted right so that I'll be able to hear audiobooks.
Nothing is strange.
Cloak with a snort. A handsome manor house grew out of the darkness at the end of the straight drive, lights glinting in the diamond pane downstairs window.
Sweet. Sounds great. Works great. So the last thing I'm going to need to do is just drill one more hole in the center console, in the bottom of it, so that I can get this headphone jack through it and be able to access it from inside the console. Then I'm just putting everything back together, and that is all. You can make it still be really clean and look factory, and you'll end up with a great, basically the best thing ever for your car. For all of us driving older cars that don't already have one, this is a really affordable way to put one in without having to swap out the whole deck and spend over $100 on a new head unit. Okay, so real quick before I button it all the way back up, I did run these underneath this piece of carpet up underneath there, and then I was able to clip them in to this wiring clip and run them along this side to keep them out of the way of that emergency brake. Okay, and there you have it. There is my super clean install. Everything looks stock. Even when you open it up, you can barely see that little switch there. When you open up the center console, I went ahead and kind of just swirled up the most of the wire, just because for the most part it's just going to be whoever's driving or whoever is in the passenger seat that's using it, and so you only need it about that long, and then you can just drop your phone right there where the cup holders go. Anyway, really clean. I'll pull this out and show you what I did underneath. I just drilled one little tiny hole up underneath. That little mat covers it quite nicely. And there you have it. So that is the end of this episode of Dirtcheapdaily. I hope this gave you some ideas on ways that you can install an auxiliary port in your own car. You don't have to resort to putting in a new head unit, and you don't have to resort to not having an auxiliary port in your car. There are some other ways to do this. You can get like an FM radio transmitter, which keys in on, you plug it into your cigarette lighter and it does that kind of thing. I've never really liked those. Sometimes you can get really bad quality sound out of them, and they just kind of look chintzy, having a big thing sticking out of your cigarette lighter. So I really like this way. It's basically permanent. If you wanted to sell the car without it, you could uninstall it and put it in any other car. They work great. I've been using them for 3 or 4 years now, and I've never had any issues. So highly recommend them. I'll go ahead and put all the links to everything that I purchased down below. And if you have any questions, go ahead and drop a comment. But please give this video a thumbs up and subscribe for more DIY car hacks. Anyway, we will see you later, and thanks for watching.